Hello, and welcome back to Stu Structures. We're here today to take a look at Railroadiana, so stay tuned. Welcome back to Stu Structures. You know, everybody out there kind of collects model trains, but a lot of the people that have model trains and have layout rooms have a lot of real railroad artifacts and various hard goods or paper goods and things that actually were part of the original railroad. And a lot of people collect these things, and there's a term for it called Railroadiana. I've got a lot of Railroadiana, I collect mainly B&O, although I do have a few other odd things in my collection. And I'm not going to go through and picture everything I got, but I'm going to go through and give you pictures of some of the things that I have in paper goods and collectibles and even some big items, so you'll understand what Railroadiana is all about, and then you can go out and collect a few things for your railroad room. I imagine most of you probably already have. So anyway, let's just jump into this and we'll start talking about some Railroadiana. Now, there are all kinds of things out there, big and small, and this is just one of the signals, the CPLs, off the B&O Railroad. It's a real heavy cast iron early version of the signal. It needs to be restored, but this will look nice if I can figure a way to mount it in my railroad room eventually. Also on the same signal, there was a single aspect light, so the guy that sold it to me also included this. And these all came from around the Mount Airy, Maryland on the main line, so there's a little bit of history that I know to it. I also have this potbelly stove. This came out of the Frederick, Maryland station around 1900 after they installed electric heat in the building. And this was given to me by a gentleman that his father worked at Mount Clair on the B&O Railroad. This had been abused for years. He recast one of the legs that was missing, but the rest of it's all intact, so it'll be nice in the room someday. I also have one set of crossbucks. These are the cat's eye marble types of signals, and this one's in really, really good shape. It also has a two-track sign that mounts down below it on the same thing. And there's a lot of things that are just associate local history. This is a milk can, and it has a label on it that was soldered on it. And this would have taken cream from a dairy in Ohio and brought it to a lady in Grafton. I have never looked up the information on it to see what she used this to make, and whether it was ice cream or what it was in Grafton, but it just ties the railroad with the specific town that I modeled. And these two bricks here are from what was the huge roundhouse in Grafton, West Virginia at one time. This has been gone forever. The turntable is still in place, but the roundhouse sadly is all gone. There's all kinds of various size cans. This would have been used for kerosene back in the day. It has a little wooden stopper in the end and is labeled B&O. Just a nice example of the can. A little damaged, but not bad. And the engineers would have used these oil cans everywhere they stopped on a steam locomotive. They had one of these stashed along the railroad somewhere with oil in it, and they would go around and oil some of the highest friction areas of moving parts on the steam locomotives. And then, of course, there was also these small oil cans that would have been used in smaller shops or roundhouses or that types of things for applying oil to tools or whatever was necessary. And these are soldering irons. Back in the day, these would have been put into a really hot fire and become glowing red. And when they were that hot, they would take them out and solder with. How would you like to have to solder some of your model railroad track with a solder iron like this? Anyway, there's all kinds of Railroadiana out there. None of this actually came from real railroads, but I have a lot of this little small stuff, and it's just small knickknacks to have around. This was a drink container. This actually was produced by a company in Grafton, West Virginia called the Wonder Drink Company, and these would have been used on the B&O passenger service for actually drinks. This would have been a radio back in the Chessie era. This came from a Monongah division. I'm not sure who it actually belonged to. The battery is deceased. I'm not sure if they use the same frequencies. I might try getting this usable again. Here's a headrest cover from the chassis era during the B&O and C&O passenger use. This would have been used on the backs of the chairs. Some people were finicky about their hair touching where other people's hair had been with due process. I guess that was a good thing. This was a spacer. It's a fiber spacer. I don't know how this was used in between the rails. This is a little wooden circular thing. I don't know if they kept maps in this or what it was actually used for, but everything is wood on this. The wood top screws down into it. These were C&O caboose lights. The B&O at the end of caboose use was needing some cabooses, and they bought a bunch off of the C&O, and these lights would have came off of those cabooses that they bought for the C&O during that period of time. And this is a caboose whistle. This would have been on the rear end of the caboose. Back in the day before radios, the caboose and the steam locomotives used to talk back and forth using codes on whistles. I also have a blueprint of the codes, a sign that would have hung on the back for the codes also. And these are date nails or time nails or, you know, these were used in railroad ties. And a lot of times this was a way to track the manufacturers and how long the ties lasted or how well they wore over time. And of course there's insulators. Everybody, you know, has an insulator or two in their collection. These are just a lot of various types that I've came across over the years. There's one wooden one there. There's some plastic ones. Of course, most of them are glass. And then there's all kinds of lanterns out there. This is a nice example with a red globe. I don't have a whole lot of lanterns, but you know, this is a nice one. Needs to probably be cleaned up just a little bit, or at least the dust knocked off of it. This would have been a safety light for a little later in time, once again with a red globe, but the little, you know, at the end of steam, into the early diesel era. And this is a more modern light. This would have been from the chassis era when this was out, the end of the chassis era. A conductor I knew who's deceased now gave this to me, and he was a conductor on Monongah Division for years. He also gave me these fusees, which came off the caboose that he worked on. I'm not sure if these, how they break down over time. These might be becoming a little bit dangerous to have, actually. And this hard hat was just from a B&O Historical Society convention one summer. We toured a few of the industries that the B&O served, and we had to have hard hats for that. These are just buttons. These came would have been used on a B&O conductor's uniform on a passenger train. And they were never ever used. I thought someday I might have a coat to use them on. You know, the railroad was always putting out different types of handouts. This is just one on a short history of the B&O Railroad, and they offered them to passengers or in passenger stations for people that were curious about the railroad. It was good publicity. Every time a new train came out, there were handouts, you know, concerning that particular train. This was from the Columbian passenger train that came out. Some passenger trains and stations had these. These are just little short collaring books for kids to collar and look at. And, you know, they just taught the kids something about the railroad as well. And then there's all kinds of books. This is one that a engineer would have kept track of his logs in. And every day when he went in, he would log in the engineer or the engine's number that he was running that day, his time in, time out, maybe how many miles he had. There's a lot of different ones have different information in them. But this tells you a lot about his time for a year. You know, these are checks from the Coal and Coke Railroad Company. This was a company that the B&O absorbed, and this just gives you information about some of the vendors that they dealt with and what kind of expenses they may have had. This is just another handout here that gives pictures of some of the highlights along and views along the railroad. Here's another one from a bicentennial celebration that they were having. And just, you know, once again, another handout. Just a nice little piece of information on the railroad. And there were all kinds of these rule books out there. You know, everybody had to know what to do, how to do it, what not to do. And there were rule books for just about everything. This one right here is for working freight trains in a, you know, specific area. There were certain rules of what you had to do and how you had to do it, like everywhere on the railroad. And these books just did that. And a lot of times schedules came in little, wallet-sized cards as well, instead of just the big printed ones, and then people could carry them with them a lot more readily. And this is just one of those, and the picture that's on the other side. And there's all kinds of tickets, coupons, and various things you can collect out there as well. I have a few different tickets that were used over the years, and these are just interline coupons from one of those sets of books there. So there you kind of have a look of Railroadiana. The layout that I want to build, if I ever get a building that I can do what I want to in, it has to be a pretty good sized building. So, at the end of that building, I would also like to have a shop and a place where I can store all my research material and a place to sit down with people and, talk about things, or, just sit around the potbelly stove and keep warm on a winter's day and play with trains or whatever. I do have a lot of this, a little more than some people and not as much as other people. I like the real stuff. Some of it's big and some of it's getting quite expensive to go out there and try to find and buy nowadays. And there are some things that it's just almost impossible to get your hands on. So in any case, I hope you learned something from this. I hope you enjoyed this video. It gives you kind of a better idea of what's out there in the way of Railroadiana. Like and subscribe to my channel. A lot of people don't know this information is out there and would like to know a resource for learning some of the things that I teach on my channel. So share this with all of them. Hit the little bell next to the subscribe button down below and you'll be notified when the next episode comes out on my channel, whether it's building buildings or talking about Railroadiana or any other odd subjects that I come up with along the way. In any case, I said in the last couple of videos, it's winter time. It's a good time to break out your trains and play. You can't go out and cut the grass and do some of the other things that you may have been doing during the rest of the year, which kept you away from doing it. So jump out there and scratch, build some buildings, and run your trains, and happy model railroading.